Good morning, everyone.
Good morning
to all of you that are here and all of you who are online. It's wonderful to have this spiritual community that we have, that we call Ahiah Center for Spiritual Living. I think somebody needs to give me a cup of coffee. Ahiah Center for Spiritual Living here in downtown Pasadena. You know, my husband Gabriel is down in Mexico. He might be watching right now. And so when Gabriel's not at home, I have to take care of myself. I fall apart. So anyway, it's good to be here with you, though. Reverend Mike, who is our assistant minister, is in Missouri right now. He's there with Marcia. They're at a special conference together. And so we wish them well, knowing absolutely that as any one of us in this family that we call Ahiah is not able to be here, not able to be online, that we still hold you in our hearts, that you're still part of our spiritual community. And so I just want to go ahead and get this party rolling here, and I want to start off by just saying a few thank yous to the people who helped me to put this on this morning. I'm going to start off with our music team, and we have a guest singer. Her name is Connie Rouse, and she's joined by Karen Golan this morning. Let's give them a great round of applause. And then we have on our piano, we have Genghis on our piano, we have Leon on the bass, we have Brian on the drums. So we're well supported in our music team this morning. For our practitioner of the day, we've already had Chris Glick up here. He did our morning meditation so beautifully just a little bit ago. And it really got me started. Maybe that's why I'm still a little unfocused at the moment. Yeah, I was down with Chris on that meditation, absolutely. And we have plenty of people who help us with the service each and every week. We have tickling the keys on the computer in the back is Harris. Let's give him a round of applause. Leon's doing our sound now, so thanks to Leon again for that. And then we have Sandra and I think Dorothy are our greeters today. So and we have Troy that's here making sure, and Frederick that are making sure that the facilities are all working and everything. So we're well cared for. We get to have a wonderful service today. And so let's go ahead and get this service started with a nice little meditation video created by Gabriel each week. And we're just gonna invite you to just take a deep breath in with me. And let that breath go. And as we let that breath go, we just let go of everything and settle back in. Let the music and the images take us to a place inside that knows that it knows that it knows.
When I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky, the first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion, run my fingers through his mane, or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears, and I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. I'll leave my heart wide open, I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. With my granddad, and he'll match me step for step, and And I'll tell him how I missed him every minute since he left. Oh, and then I'll hug his neck. Oh, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. And I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer. There's so much work to do. Oh, when I get where I'm going and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Oh, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. And I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. And I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Oh, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here.
That's a lovely song. You know, but what we teach here in this philosophy is that what he sings about in that song is an ultimate. But it's really about the journey of getting to that ultimate. It's about us living that life just a little bit more each and every day. We can live in heaven right here, experience that truth right here in our own lives. So I'm going to go ahead and ask Chris Glick, our practitioner, come up. He's going to do our reading and invocation. But while he does that, I'm going to go ahead and light the peace candle today, knowing that Chris in his prayer is absolutely going to keep the idea of peace in his prayer.
Good morning, Ahiah. It is something that I am very grateful for to be here today. And I just want to start with where I am. So I'm right here. And in another part of the world, I know that it's 10 hours later. So I'm not really bound by what time it is or any of those things. But I know that I'm right here where I am. That's where I am. And in that space, I would like to share with you something that I wrote before I do the prayer. And this is in entirety in the Ahiah newsletter, and I would welcome anybody to read. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but it's very appropriate to where I am. And when I say right here where I am, I could say right here where you are, because we are and God is. And what I'm going to start with is the title. This is called The Vortex at Weiba. So I had to learn how to pronounce Weiba. To me, it's an L, a capital L, but it has a little accent thing, like the one you would put over the word cafe if you're speaking French. So it has one of these in the upper part of the L, and it's because you pronounce it Weiba. Some of the letters in Poland still retain some of the old way of writing them. So I'll start. This is really about change. And just like the song that Connie so graciously gave us, or will, she did it during rehearsal. So I am already there. It is about change. There are moments in our lives which define, encompass, and move us to the truth of who we are. They appear when we become aware of them, and then they disappear. The reason they disappear is so that the next moment can be experienced. One such moment happened when we, my wife and I, Deborah, who is also the treasurer on the board here, we were visiting our son and his family in Poland. Many of you remember Bram used to play here in the band, and we still have him with us. So we were visiting Bram and his family in Poland. This during the COVID lockdown of 2020, they moved to Gdansk. And it's a Polish city on the Baltic Sea. So they moved there to follow their dreams. Life had become very difficult in Los Angeles with the pandemic and so on. My children had reached a point in their lives when change was beckoning. It was time to listen to that inside voice, time to surrender to that, and let spirit decide what is best. So 2 years later, they just picked us up at the Gdansk airport in Poland 2 weeks ago, and because we hadn't seen them for 2 years, this moment when we arrived was all smiles and hugs. An unforgettable moment of connection and reuniting. It was a love dance. The invitation to change is not always clear at first. So the universe provides experiences to help bring us to the consciousness that allows and says yes to the new. At first, there are gentle prods. The idea of being where the sun shines. Love fills us with joy. Just calming the searching soul with the wonder of new experience. Meanwhile, other experiences try to pull us back into whatever keeps us feeling safe and comfortable. Essentially, there are two ways of being. Once we become aware of them as choices available to us, we can go forward with no expectations, allowing the universe to pull us into change. Or we can stay in the safety and comfort of no change. When we stay in safety and comfort, growth and change become stagnant. An example is the ingrown toenail. Anybody ever had one of those? When its outward growth is hampered, it begins to grow inward. This can result in pain as we attempt to rectify the problem. When we choose to allow new possibilities, exuberant existence becomes our reality. Exuberant existence becomes our reality. If we do not choose anything, havoc appears as, at first, as a boat gently floating on the sea, but quickly ramps up until it becomes a tempest, pushing us into a hellish existence, taking all until nothing is left. When my son and his family moved to Poland, the tempest was threatening their very lives. In fact, the tempest picked them up and blew them out of the trap they perceived they were in. It was one of those turning point moments in their lives which propelled them forward. There were no expectations, just a knowing that this was the right thing to do. That was one such moment. Thank you. Now just allow this moment right here to be that time when we go inside and know that God is. I know that I am. I know that you are. Therefore, I know that we are. We are all one. I recognize this one, this presence. As I say, I am, you are, God is. That's all there is. And without even thinking, a smile appears on the reflection of your faces when you look at mine. It's all there is. And in this moment, we recognize that is all there is. And we feel that in our beings as we light up inside, we reflect outward light. In that moment, we connect with the one presence. Going by many names, because that's an energy, it's a presence. It is not anything that you touch with your finger or you stub your toe and you feel some pain. That's not anything. It's that presence that you feel inside, the knowing that this presence we call many names. We call Buddha, Jesus, Moses, God, Spirit, love, peace, joy. Yet it is just what it is, a presence, knowing that I am, you are, God is, we are. And I give thanks knowing that this service today is masterfully, lovingly prepared by our own Reverend Scott Olson. And that all the people today that are here are part of this presence, this talk, the music. This is all one. And as we are all part of this, we join together as one. We are this symbol of the yin-yang. We are all that there is. We are unity. I give grateful thanks to this unity and the peace that is God, the peace that is the truth. I recognize this is all God. And I release this word, knowing that it is manifest, this oneness, this unity, this peace, joy, love is manifest. And together we say, and so it is. Amen and amen.
Thank you, Chris.
You're welcome.
So I'm going to go ahead and ask Connie and Karen to come on up. And as they are coming on up, go ahead and just give a nice warm welcome to each of the people here in our sanctuary. And if you're at home, you can say hello to whoever you're with at home. Oh, yes. All right. And so, take it away, Connie.
Thank you, Reverend Scott. So I'm going to go ahead and do this one alone. Good morning, Ahiah. So wonderful to see you. Always very happy to be here. Karen will be joining me on the next song. But like Chris said earlier, we're going to do a little song about change. It's inevitable. And as I was listening to this song and reading the lyrics, I realized how very resistant I can sometimes be to change. But if you just let go and let it happen, it's always for the best, right? Mm-hmm. that's the way of time. Nothing and no one, oh, unchanged. There are not many things in life you can be sure of.
So we have a theme for August, which is the elements of life. And, you know, that thought, that idea really intrigues me, because the elements of life, it has a real meaning as a scientist. You know, there are many, many scientists that are equally fascinated with this and that are out there searching for life out beyond this world. We know that it's easy to make life here on this world, because everywhere we look, there's life. Sometimes even places we don't want it to be, right? We want to have a germ-free existence sometimes, and we find them all over the place. And everywhere we look on the surface of this planet, we seem to find life there. But when we look out beyond this planet, we look, for instance, this is a picture of the moon with the Earth, you know, seeing the Earth from the moon. And what you see is you see a planet, a moon, that is devoid of life, no life there. And you see out in the distance, you know, hundreds of thousands of miles away, you see this blue planet that is teeming with life. And we've got, you know, we've gone beyond our moon, we've gone to Mars now. And so this is a picture of our planet from Mars. And you see again, you see the lifeless planet of Mars, and you see beyond it, this tiny little, if you were to magnify that little speck, it would be a blue speck of life that's hanging up in the firmaments. And you know, it's funny, when we look at Mars from here, we see a red planet, because all the water of life in Mars, it's been mostly incorporated in the soil. It's rust. And so we see a very different thing when we look at Mars. And here we have all of the elements of life that are needed. We have an atmosphere that we can breathe. We have water. We have, you know, nature and this connection to nature. We just have to step outside, walk in the forest, go down to the beach, and we're immersed in the harmony and the natural order that is life here on this planet. Now, you know, man has proved to be a great creator. We are endowed with this ability to create. And we get to create whatever we want. And Sometimes what we create is wonderful. And sometimes we have created a bunch of things that maybe aren't the best. We've created war. We've created pollution. We've created chemicals, and we've created plastic. You know, we have an entire ocean that has, you know, got areas of it that are filled with plastic. And so, you know, I believe that the way forward for this human race is to look at its creative ability and really focus on what do we need to do so that we take this earth, this blue ball that's out there, this ball that is our home, this ball that is teeming with life, and make sure that we are being good stewards of what we have. That our science out there is taking into account, you know, what ecology needs, what our planet needs, renewable energy, those types of things. So, you know, the elements of life are everywhere, and that's wonderful. And today's talk title is The Water of Life. And so I'm going to focus in a little bit on water, and I want to talk about the physical aspect of water first. I want to talk about how that shows up in our lives. And, you know, we have it in abundance on this planet, don't we? It's everywhere. Do you know that 71% of the surface of our planet is water? So we're mostly the surface of the planet, 71% water, only 29% dry land. And so we have an abundance of water everywhere, which makes our planet blue when you look at it from space. We're a blue planet, filled with water everywhere. And, you know, there's this connection to water. John Muir, he says this. You know who John Muir is? He was a great naturalist. And there's a John Muir trail that goes along the west coast of the United States through Canada, or through California and Oregon and Washington. I'm not sure, does it go into Canada or not? No, it ends. So I've walked pieces of the John Muir Trail here and there as I've gone through hikes and all. And he says, when we contemplate the whole globe as one great dewdrop, this blue dewdrop that floats out there, striped and dotted with continent and island, flying through space with other stars, all singing and shining together as one, the whole universe appears as an infinite storm of beauty. You know, we're surrounded. We are fortunate to live that life. And water seems to be so important to life. So important. Our bodies itself are 60% water. Did you know that? You're a bag of water is what you are, really. And so we want nice, pure water to be in our bodies. And, you know, when scientists, when they go out and they look for the possibility of life out beyond our planet, the first thing that they do is they look for water. They look, is there a possibility on that planet that there's liquid water somewhere to be had? And, you know, it takes a couple of things for that to be true. The first thing is that the planet has to be in what's called the habitable zone. It's a sweet spot. It's far enough away from the planet, from the sun, whatever sun it's circling, that it's not too hot. And not so far away that it gets nice and cold and everything freezes. And so the water, to be liquid, you know, it can't be too cold. You know, Mars, our next planet out, you know what the average temperature of Mars is? It's minus 81 degrees Fahrenheit. Minus 81. How would you like to walk around that for a day? Yeah. And, you know, you don't want it to be too hot, so you get to our next closest planet, which is Venus, next closest to the sun, And its average temperature is 847 degrees Fahrenheit. That's hot enough to melt lead, you know? So we're fortunate. Where the earth is in this sweet spot where you can have, you know, you can have liquid water right here on the surface, ready for us to drink. And the scientists, they've decided, well, you know, we've been to Mars, there's nothing out there, and there's no life on Mars. We're looking to see if maybe in the past there was life on Mars. But there's none right now. And so we're looking beyond to the moons in the solar system. We've got two candidates, Enceladus, which is a moon of Saturn, and Europa, which is a moon of Jupiter, where they think there might be liquid water. And therefore, maybe some life as we know it on this planet. And maybe, in the infinite creativeness that spirit is, maybe there's life on other planets that doesn't look anything like this. Maybe that's true too. So maybe we'll find other life out there as we keep looking. But you know, water is essential to us. In fact, Benjamin Franklin, he says, when the well is dry, we know the worth of water. And so right now we're in a place where, you know, our science has created enough change on this planet that, you know, you guys know the global climate change is real, right? You know, there's this in the media, there's this debate on whether it's real or not. But, you know, if you talk to scientists, I'm a scientist. I have degrees in applied physics, so I think like a scientist. And when you go look at the peer-reviewed materials out there, the stuff that scientists look at and publish, there's no debate about it in the literature. So climate change is real. And what we see is that climate change, as the world gets hotter, the oceans are sending more water into the air. And that sounds like a good thing, except for now that water has to come down. And so we'll get hurricanes that are bigger, and we'll get, you know, things like Kentucky showing up. And so, you know, the point, why am I talking about all this? This isn't a science lecture, is it? No, we're here for a spiritual journey. But, you know, I wanted to say a few words, take a few minutes to talk about this from the perspective that we don't always see it in the news. We don't see it on Facebook. You know, we don't get that information available to us. And so, you know, I just wanted to raise awareness that we have a planet here that we need to take care of. This blue dot, you know, that one, that's our planet. That's something that's important to us. That's something that Spirit has given us. And like when we talk about prosperity, we talk about stewardship. In prosperity, we have to take care of things that we already have in order to have more. And so it's important. But I will get off of this science tour, and we'll talk about water from a more spiritual perspective, because there's a lot to be said from the aspect of what water means in a spiritual context. You know, water has always been a symbol for humanity of life, purification, and hope. That's what water means in a spiritual context. Life, purification, and hope. And so there's also been this imagery forever of water as the mind that God is. The one mind. And I think that we use that imagery because we've all got this idea, concept of an ocean. You know, when you stand at the edge of an ocean, you can feel the vastness of that ocean. You can feel it like it's infinite in nature. It's never ending. You look, and everywhere you look is water. And if you've been out on the ocean, if you've been out far enough that you can't see land, everything around you is just water. And so we have, as humans, we have that connection with this idea that water is infinite. We can have this body of water, just like the mind that God is infinite in nature. And the Bible's verse here, John 4:14, it talks about that a little bit. It says, "But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." And I think what that means is that there is this one mind that we all share. That's the water. And where is it located? It's located inside of us. We don't find that kind of water. We don't find the spiritual water out in a lake somewhere. We find it here within us, the mind that God is. And we have to drink of the water. What does it mean to drink of the water? It means to actively recognize that life, actively know it. And even though that water, that wellspring of life, lives within us, is easily found when you look down inside, we have, as humans, we have the ability to ignore it. We have the ability even to disavow it. It's not there. It's not true. I don't believe in the water, right? I don't believe in spirit. We can do that if we want, because we're free to do that. But when we recognize it, when we turn our attention on spirit and we drink of that water, we recognize the truth of it as us, then great things happen. You know, Alison Krauss, she wrote a song called Down to the River to Play. And it's a traditional song. It's been around for a long time. And it's mostly a Christian song. But I think there's a verse in that song that really talks about everything that we need to understand about water as the spiritual aspect of us. And here I have the verse I'm talking about out of it. It says, "As I went down in the river to play, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way." Who's ever heard that song? Well, Alan raised his hand. You know, Alan is a music director, so he knows a lot of songs. Back at my old Center for Spiritual Living, we used to sing this one in the choir every once in a while. And our music director in those days, she was from Kentucky. And she'd sing it with this kind of spiritual, you know, southern twang a little bit. Sonny Cantrell Smith, Reverend Sonny. So I remember this phrase lives in my head. And it tells us everything that we need to know about the spiritual life of water. Because it says, first of all, that we need to go down in the river to pray. Prayer is our way of connecting with this life, this power, this presence, the one life, the one mind that God is. And when we get down to the river, we don't walk on the banks of the river. We walk in the river. We go down in the river. We immerse ourselves in the river. We drink of the water that is the river. We know it to be the truth of ourselves. And as we wade in that water, we study that water. We study the life that God is. And we know from that, we know it to be the truth of ourselves. And in this third line, it asks us, who shall wear the robe and crown? Who shall wear the robe and crown? We shall wear the robe and crown. Every last one of us wears the robe and crown. When we're down in the river and we pray, We're knowing the truth of us. We're knowing that we are the creative essence of the divine. We call it something special in this philosophy. We call it the Christ consciousness. We call it this Christ consciousness. We say the Christ because we're talking about Jesus, not from the perspective of Jesus as being this unique being, but from the perspective of Jesus being the great example of what each and every one of us can attain. That we can each and every one of us attain the knowingness that Spirit the Father lives within. That we're all one in this life that God is. And when we know that, we recognize that we have the power. We have the robe and the crown. We are the life. We are the power. We are the presence. We create from the power that Spirit is into our lives. And so as these divine creatures that we are, at the very center of each and every one of our universe, we are the center of our own universe, aren't we? We say, "Good Lord, show me the way," the last line of this verse. Good Lord, show me the way. And isn't that what I talk about each and every week here? Every week I say, just let Spirit guide you. And that's what we do. This whole idea, as I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. So as we create, we allow ourselves to be led by Spirit. The world's so complex. It keeps getting more complex. And so, do I really want my finite mind to be guiding me? Do I want the ego to guide me, or do I want the infinite intelligence that Spirit is to guide me? Chris's, reading of his song, Son, Bram. I remember Bram. You know, Bram played, as Chris mentioned, he played the saxophone here for, a couple years? Yeah. And, I played the tenor saxophone when I was a kid, and so I love listening to Bram. I still, sometimes I kind of add in a little Bram as I'm listening to the music here. So Bram, if you're watching online, dude, I still miss you. But that story of change is wonderful. That story of change is what we need to do. And Spirit absolutely guides us when we go down in the river to pray and just say, Spirit, let me know. What am I supposed to do next? And so I want to leave you today. This is our affirmation today, but there's a picture there that Harris has put into it, which I think is great. It's a picture of a man. That little dot in the center there is a man that's standing there on the water. And all around him, right in front of him, is his reflection in the water. Have you guys ever gone down to the water and looked at your reflection? Here's one of those things. When you go down to the water to look at your reflection, when the water is turbulent, all right, when it's moving fast, you really can't see yourself. You know, there's so much movement on the surface, there's a reflection of you, but it's going all over the place. But when the water is still, when the water is calm, when the water's like glass, we call it, you look down into that water, you see yourself as a perfect reflection. And so that's a reminder that we want to look for ourselves, look for our reflection in the mind that God is, when we allow things to be still, allow them to be calm. That's what meditation is about. It's about stilling the mind so that we can see ourselves in the reflection of God. That's what it's all about. And so as we go down to the river to pray, go down in the river to pray, we allow ourselves, our mind to still, we allow ourselves to be able to look into the water, we allow ourselves to see ourselves reflected back in that water. And we come to a place of peace. We come to a place of harmony. We come to a place where we're no longer in our head, we're now in our heart. And when we live from a place of being in our heart, everything is wonderful. It's all peace. It's all joy. And so we have an affirmation today that I'd like for us to read together. So go ahead and read it along with me. I am a reflection of the essence of life. Let's say that again. I am a reflection of the essence of life. And so I want you to just remember, as you go out into your week this week, I'd like you to think about, you know, notice the water that's around you. It's everywhere, isn't it? It rains sometimes here in Southern California. It rains. But there's water that we see all around us anyway. And as you see that water, you know, just be thankful for this blue dot that we call the earth. Be thankful for this place that we call our home. Be thankful for spirits, providence, for its givingness, for giving us this planet that we are now stewards of. And then so as we do that, we recognize that we need to be stewards of all that we are given, good stewards of all that we're given. And so we get to think about, what can we do to live a more natural life? What can we do to live more in harmony with the life that God is as this planet? And then when you think of the waters of life, just, you know, go down in the river to pray. And renew and rejuvenate yourself when you do that. Just be quiet, allow yourself to be renewed for the energy that God is to well up within you, the peace that Spirit is, to be the truth of you. And as always, when you do that, my suggestion to you is to just let Spirit guide you. Thank you, and namaste. And so Angus is going to play a little bit underneath my prayer. As I say a prayer to just remind us of this truth, this life, this power, this presence, this Spirit is everywhere and always at the very core of our being. To know this life, this power, this water of life, the one mind that God is, as the source of all that there is, as the source of the infinite abundance on this planet and all the other planets in the solar system and everything in this entire universe, that Spirit is the source of all of that good. And as that's true of God, I know it to be the truth of myself. I know it to be the truth of each and every one of us that are here today, and also those who are online, that we are the life, the power, the presence that God is moving. It's moving through us and as us. This one mind that we all share encompasses us, our minds. The love and the peace and the joy that Spirit is therefore my birthright. It is the truth of each and every one of us. And it's from that place of knowingness that I speak my word as the truth of each and every one of us, knowing absolutely that this creation that we call the earth is absolutely the mother of us all in so many ways. It has its own consciousness, as in all of the life that lives on it. And as we come together in the oneness that God is, we support that life. We support this planet. We support this ecology, this environment that is so necessary to life. We know absolutely that spirit is on our side. That just like when our bodies are not revealing the wholeness and the order and the truth that we are, that as the earth has that same effect, that we can reveal more and more of the natural order that is the truth of it. Reveal the natural health of this planet. Reveal all that there is, and know absolutely that we, as a species, as a one mind that God is being led to help this planet move forward towards greater and greater and greater health always. I know absolutely that we, individually, as the one mind that God is, we drink of that water. We drink of the life that God is naturally. It just flows up through us and has us at the very core of our being. And so I say life is good. Life is so, so good. I know absolutely that that's the truth of us. And so I just give thanks for that knowingness. And I release this prayer to the law, knowing that it's already revealed in the mind that God is. And I say life and God are good and very good. And together we say, and so it is. Amen and amen. And so now is the time for our conscious contributions. Thank you, Genghis. And so we, I know that many of you have already given online. If you have not, and you're here in the sanctuary, there are offering envelopes in the pews that you can put your offering in, and we have our ushers, Dorothy and Sandra, coming forward. And we also have these, Ernie $100 bills. You know, that are a sign of our contribution when we've done it online. You can always throw that into the basket also. And if you're online, there are three ways for you to give. We have Ahiah Sunday Celebration, 229-2225, or you can always mail in a check. And I love getting those little love notes that people often put into the checks, in with the checks. So thank you for those. And so, however you have given, let's just virtually place that offering to our heart as we say this blessing. This gift I give is God in action. I send it forth with joy, confidence, and ease. I am blessed by the law of giving and receiving as I now share my gift with life. Press down, shaken together, and running over. And so it is. Amen. And so now I'd like to go ahead and ask Connie and Karen to come on up. They're going to give us a lovely song that's going to kind of lift our spirits and know the truth. Thank you.
I've been too afraid to let it show, cause I'm scared of the judgment that may follow. Always put up living for tomorrow. It's time to step out on faith. I gotta show my faith. It's been elusive for so long, but freedom is mine today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We had lots to talk about on the side, so we should be very chatty over here now, right? Today, we put water into some containers, like 12 ounce and an 8 ounce and a 4 ounce, and we talked about whether or not we could add more water, and we realized that those containers were limited. So we took that discussion to talk about abundance and things in our own life and how we can expand. We are not those containers. And some of the ways that we can expand our consciousness would be, Perry?
Thank you.
Friendships.
Kindness.
How about you?
Yes.
Love. Yes. And we made a collage that says God is the source of our good. And so all the things that we currently love and have in our life, we put in the collage. And also, I'm going to give the microphone to Perry and Phoebe because they're going to talk a little bit about camp. They haven't been able to do that yet. So they want to tell you what they love.
All right.
Perry, and my favorite thing about camp is being with people.
I'm Phoebe, and the thing I love about camp was meeting new friends and going on an airplane without my mom.
Thank you. Thank you from us. All right, let's go.
Miss Lisa didn't say no to any junk food or anything.
Oh, freedom. Oh, Lordy. So, a few announcements. We have the Women's Circle meeting this Friday here. It is with Lisa, that you saw right now, and one of our practitioner emeritus, Patricia Roach. And the theme for this month is, they're going to be talking about grief. And in fact, they have a guest speaker coming in. I know Reverend Donna Baranier personally. And she is spectacular. I've heard her talking about pastoral care and grief support and all before for many years. And I think all of that is very good stuff. And they've got some other things also on their menu for this coming Friday. So this Friday the 19th from 7 to 9 p.m. on Zoom. And we have a musical celebration, which is with Ricky Byers and Michael Gott. Who knows Ricky Byers here? Who knows her music? I guarantee if you've been going to a CSL for any time at all, and we do congregational music in particular, you'll know Ricky Byers' music because, you know, it is so beautiful, it is so heartfelt. You know, songs like Use Me are from her. And so she is absolutely spectacular. I can't wait for this musical celebration. And we also have Michael Gott. Michael Gott, he has a voice like, oh my God. You know, whenever I listen to Michael Gott's music, and I've been listening to him for years, I know him very well. He's going to actually be the minister who does my ordination. He's going to be in charge of the ordination. And so he's out here. He's going to speak on the Sunday after. Michael Gott, by the way, is not just a singer. He's also the minister. He's the senior minister at Unity Houston, which is the largest Unity church that they have. He's very, very well known. And we're going to be very fortunate to have him here on that Sunday. So he's here for the 24th, September 24th, not August 24th, September 24th, for my ordination ceremony. He's singing in the concert afterwards, and then he's here speaking on the 25th. So make sure you put that on your calendar. Tickets are for sale now, so go grab them while there's good seats to be had. And you can get there by going to ahiah.com/80. It has all the links that you need for the ordination and for the celebration, the musical celebration. And I just talked about the ordination. So if you are coming to the ordination, there's going to be lunch provided afterwards. We need to have a count of who's going to be here so that we have the right number of lunches. Right now we have 60 lunches ordered. That's what the board has approved. So you want to be in the first 60 that RSVP. So you can get there by going to ahiah.com/80. We are going to be charging $5 for parking because we have to rent the parking lot across the street. And then we've talked about the Hollywood Bowl. There are 33 tickets sold already. We have 40 tickets, so there's 7 more if you want them. I suggest that you grab them now. And the ball game, we've got 18 tickets sold out of the 20 that we purchased. We might buy a few more, we'll see about that. But so if you really want what those last two tickets that are out there, I suggest that you go get them now. Because I'm not sure whether we'll be able to get more of those. So both of these events are great ways for us to come together in community. Remember that we have the books. We have a wonderful, wonderful group of practitioners here at Ahiah. If you're a practitioner here, would you go ahead and stand up? I know we have Chris, and we got Frederick, we have Myrna back there. So we're well supported by our practitioners, and they would love, love, love to pray with you afterwards. If you're online, you're looking to get contact information for them to talk to them, you can always go to ahiah.com/meet-our-practitioners. And it has the contact information there. And that was interesting. Let's try that. And then we also have prayer support by online by you just going to ahiah.com/prayers, fill in a prayer request, and that goes directly to me. It's only ever seen by the ministers and practitioners here at Ahiah. And then we have a quick lift me up throughout the week. It's a different dial a prayer every week, and you can go to ahiah.com/dialaprayer, or you can go to our just call into the main line here and press number 7. Get you there. So it's been wonderful being with you guys today. Be happy to chat with you after service here as we finish up with our benediction. So I would love for you to just go ahead and read this with me. Something wonderful is happening through me right now. It is this thing called life. Life is in my mind. Life is in my body. Life is in all of my affairs. I accept it. I am it. And I share it. Just the way it appears and just the way it appears not. Thank you, God. And amen and amen. And I am so glad that we came here together today. I'm so glad that you're online with us today. And I will chat with you guys after service right back there. And it's a little warm outside, so I think I'm going to go into the fellowship hall. And if you're online, I'll go to Zoom. We can chat on Zoom. Until next week, I love you guys. See you then. Namaste, and thank you. Bye-bye.